to Matthew. At that time, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry. The tempter approached him and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones become loaves of bread." He said, replied, "It is written, one does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city, made him stand on the parapet of a temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and with their hands they will support you, lest you dash your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "Again it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." Then the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their magnificence. And he said to him, "All these I shall give to you if you will prostrate yourself and worship me." At this, Jesus said to him, "Get away, Satan. It is written, the Lord your God you shall worship, and him alone shall you serve." Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Every generation has to ask the same questions. Where did I come from? Where did all this come from? How was I created? Who created the universe? Is there such a thing as good and evil? Does God exist? Does the devil exist? Every generation has to ask these same questions. Wisdom says we learn from history, and if we don't, we're bound to repeat history. And so Jesus was led by the Spirit, an image of the Spirit, God breathing into the nostrils of man to create us from the earth, and God gives us life. And then Jesus is led by the power of the Spirit into the desert. It's the promise of the Father to send the Spirit that we receive in baptism and are sealed with the confirmation, that we are strengthened in the Spirit to be the body of Christ, to live in a new creation, to put on that new person of God's grace. And so that's what we are seeking to do during Lent, to repent and to believe. So we are seeking to grow in our believing. John's Gospel is all about believing in Jesus. And so, in the Catholic tradition, we bring belief and reason together. We don't see them as opposite, but together. So as we grow in our believing, we should also be growing in our knowledge of our faith. The devil has been around a long, long time. He's smarter than everybody here. We lack a lot in our wisdom because we've only been around a short time. He has duped many of generations. You know, as you go through time, you kind of see the rise and fall of civilizations and peoples. The question is, when did he start on us now? How did things get to be where they are now? It's kind of a big mystery. I might point back to the growth in our education system of the field of psychology, which is a good field, helps us understand ourselves better. The rebellion of the 60s, where people started doing what? Inside the church, even. Does the devil really exist? I mean, come on. They just made that up. It's scary. Do
fear you into believing, right? Sort of the mantra that has flowed the last 60 years. He's pretty smart. So to get us to disbelieve God, he started by getting us to disbelieve him. That was the cursor to where we're at today. Because if things aren't brought to the light, they have power in the Old Testament. So if Satan is suppressed, not believed in, out of the way, guess who's out of the way next? God. So now we have a generation that don't believe in God, don't believe in the church. We've lost people, right? We have grandparents today, ever knowing numbers, bringing up their grandchildren in the practice of the faith because their kids have not very bought into the lies of the generation. There is no God. We don't need organized religion, right? We see it in all our families. So, kudos to Satan. He's done a good job. He was successful in getting us to disbelieve him and disbelieve God. So every generation has to ask questions. Lent is an opportunity for us to deepen our believing in Jesus, to be more transformed in him. Jesus sent the Holy Spirit when he was raised up to be our helper, our guide, our advocate. The light of God's glory to dwell within us, to dispel the darkness and the power of sin. But we have to call on the Holy Spirit. We have to seek out God's wisdom, not our wisdom. We have to seek out God's way in all things, as we heard in the scriptures in the opening prayer that Jesus said, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. We are listening for God's voice and seeking to act on it. And so Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He came to show us how to do that. He was all about listening for the mouth of his Father to do the Father's will. He took on everything that was of our human nature. He is taking on the temptation of the evil one who seeks to distort our identity as the children of God. Notice every temptation begins with, if you are the Son of God. So he's trying to shake us at our core of who we are as made in the image and likeness of God, wanting us to doubt that, wanting us to really turn away from God and trust in our own powers, which is original sin. That was the temptation in the garden. Go ahead and eat from this pleasing fruit. The opening prayer on Ash Wednesday that we prayed that God would protect us from harmful pleasures. Harmful pleasures. Those two things go together. Aren't pleasures good? Harmful pleasures. The fruit looks so good. And the wisdom, knowledge of God. Ooh, it's good, right? A lot of things look good, but they're not. And so Jesus came to save us. He's our Savior. And so Lent gives us an opportunity as church to deepen our believing in Jesus and be more faithful in living in him. So we do prayer, fasting, and almsgiving are some of the things, the tools of Lent to help us deepen our believing. There's a little basket up here. There's two baskets. One we call our sin pot basket. It has a hole at the top. The other basket has some pieces of paper. And the purpose of that is for us to ask the Holy Spirit to scrutinize ourselves. Where is sin lurking in our lives? Where is that darkness that God wants to expose with his light? What is keeping you from a deeper union, living more fully in God's love? It always has something to do with our selfishness. Hint, hint. Okay? There's a word they use in recovery. It's called HALT. H-A-L-T. Hunger, anger, loneliness, and tiredness. You think Jesus was hungry? I don't know if he was angry. He didn't sense any anger in the scripture. But he was out in the desert all alone. Satan likes to seep in those elements of our human weakness. So think about what the Spirit guides you to scrutinize where your weaknesses are, where your sin is. I just invite you to write them on a piece of paper up here, stick them in that little basket. It's sort of a reminder to yourself. No, nobody's going to look at it. Don't put your name on it. is a reminder of where you are seeking the saving, redeeming grace of Christ as you seek to believe in Him more during the season of Lent. And the Easter Vigil, we'll burn that basket in our Easter fire as a sign of God's cleansing power in our lives. Also, in the back, as you walk out on the right, there's some little bitty boxes. We're inviting you as a community for our communal almsgiving to collect money for the Catholic Charities, for their Bridge the Gap program, to help reach the needs of the poor among us as we move through this year. So I invite you to take one of those little boxes and to consider that being your almsgiving. Bring those back in at the very end of Lent. And so Jesus was led by the Spirit. So everybody take a deep breath. And breathe out. Breathe in the Holy Spirit. Just say, come, Holy Spirit, your heart. Breathe in the Spirit and ask the Spirit to lead you during the season of Lent to more deepen your belief in Jesus, to know Him greater, to live more fully in Him so that we might love more. That's what God came to do, to show us how to love because God is love. Wouldn't that be a good thing if we